Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
There's a recorder that went missing yesterday, and that was the recorder we use to record the lectures. So I'm sure someone will record on their phone, but that's the first class recording we recorded last night. So whoever found it, please give back to me. That would be really nice. You know, it's a bit awkward. Yeah.
Yes, the recorder found.
Recorder found in the front desk.
Let me just check that.
Yeah. So we're reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, 7th canto, chapter 15, entitled Instructions for Civilized Human Beings. Don't take recorders. That are not yours. Text 68.
Yata hi yoyam nipadeva duschaya.
Yata hi yoyam nipadeva duschaya.
Apatganat utara tatmana prabho.
Apatganat utara tatmana prabho.
Yapada pankero hasevaya bhavan.
Yapada pankero hasevaya bhavan.
Sinnejitta dikka jakratam.
Ahara sinnejitta dikka jakratam.
Yata hi yuyam nipadeva juschaja.
Yata hi yuyam nipadeva juschaja.
Apatganat utara tatmana prabho.
Apatganat utara tatmana prabho.
Yat pada pankiru hasevaya bhavan. Dikka jagratam.
Padeva dushtaya.
Yatai yuyam vipadeva dushtaya.
Apatganat uttaratmatmana prabhu.
Apatganat uttaratmatmana prabhu.
Yatpada pankeruha sevaya bhavan.
Yatpada pankeruha sevaya bhavan.
Ahara shindra chitta dikka chakratun.
Ahara shindra chitta dikka chakratun.
Ladies.
Yatahi
yuyam nipadeva duschaya.
Apatganat utara tatmana prabhu.
Apatganat utara tatmana prabhu.
Yatpada pankeru sevaya bhavan.
Yatpada pankeru sevaya bhavan.
Ahara shinir jita dikkaya prabhu.
Ahara shinir jita dikkaya prabhu.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Yuyam.
All of you. Pandavas.
Nipadeva.
O Lord of the Kings.
Human beings and demigods.
Duschaja.
Insurmountable.
Apa.
Dangerous conditions.
Gana.
From all.
Udarata.
Escape.
Admanaha.
Om.
Bravo.
Of the Lord.
Yadpada Pankiruha.
Whose lotus feet.
Sivaya.
By serving.
Bhava.
Yourself.
Aharasi.
Perform.
Nijita.
Defeating.
Dikkaja.
Most powerful enemies.
Or like elephants.
Kratum.
Ritualistic
ceremonies.
O King Yudhisthira, because of your service to the Supreme Lord, all of you Pandavas defeated the greatest dangers posed by numerous kings and demigods. By serving the lotus feet of Krishna, you conquered great enemies who were like elephants, and thus you collected ingredients for sacrifice. By his grace, may you be delivered from material involvement. Purport. Placing himself as an ordinary householder, Maharaj Yudhisthira inquired from Narada Muni how a Grida Mudadi, a person who is entangled in household life and who thus continues to remain a fool, can be delivered. Narada Muni encouraged Maharaj Yudhisthira by saying, "You are already on the safe side because you, along with your entire family, have become a pure devotee of Krishna. By Krishna's grace, the Pandavas conquered in the battle of Kurukshetra and were saved from many dangers posted not only by kings, but sometimes even by the demigods. Thus, they are a practical example of how to live in security and safety by the grace of Krishna. Everyone should follow the example of the Pandavas, who showed how to be saved by the grace of Krishna. Our Krishna consciousness movement is intended to teach how everyone can live peacefully in this material world and at the end of life return home back to Godhead. In the material world there are always dangers at every step. Padam padam yadvipadam natesham. Nonetheless, if one takes shelter of Krishna without hesitation and keeps under the shelter of Krishna, he can easily cross the ocean of nistas. Samasvitaya padapalavavavam mahatpadam puyaya so murare. To the devotee, this great ocean of nescience becomes like a puddle of water in the hoofprint of a cow. A pure devotee, without embarrassing himself by trying for elevation in so many ways, stays in the safest position as a servant of Krishna, and thus his life is eternally safe, without a doubt. Om Agyanatimanandasya Agyanandana Salagya Shakshuram Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurudeva Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasudeva Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So, Maharaj Yudhisthira is here asking the question about what he as a householder should do to become free from entanglement. And basically we see that a devotee is simultaneously situated in pure transcendental devotional service and also in Varnashram, which is a system to regulate material life and to engage everyone according to their natures in a pious way of living so that they can make advancement in punya, in piety. Of course, Bhagavatam is saying, Svanustitasya dharmasya sansidhir haritosanam, that one should act according to one's nature, but one must engage this in the service of the Lord, for the pleasure of the Lord. Otherwise, Varnashram itself is not transcendental. But since we are coming from the age of Kali, and without any regulation in our life, suddenly the regulations of Varna Ashram put us on a behavior that is way above what we were used to and what we were doing. Therefore, Varna Ashram is a powerful purification for us. A Vaishnava who becomes a pure devotee goes beyond Varna Ashram. Therefore, I like to use the analogy of crutches, that when one is injured, when one has become injured by Maya, when one has become so much injured by Kali that one cannot walk properly anymore on the spiritual path and apply himself to the process of devotional service, then to stay on the path we use the crutches of Varna Ashram. But when finally the broken bone is healed, then one throws the crutches away and dances down the road. And then one will simply operate on love of God. Another analogy which I would like to give is, there is a circus tent, and in the tent there is the cord on top, very high, and someone is gonna walk across. The tension's building up. A man in colorful suit is going up. He's ready to step on the tightrope. He has a stick to balance. He's walking up on that tightrope so that he may not fall down. And he's meant to be completely on the transcendental platform. But in case one gets under the influence of the modes of material, then there is a net. There is a net. And the net is the net of the mode of goodness. So this is how we live our spiritual life. Whenever we are failing in love of God, which is the transcendental platform, then we have the mode of goodness to turn to. And it's very simple, because sometimes we really feel enthusiastic about Krishna, about the holy name, about chanting and everything, about the Bhagavatam, and other times we just feel it's difficult, a burden. So then we must somehow or other return to the mode of goodness. And this is what we're training, and that is why we are embracing this Varna Ashram. And we see that Maharaj Yudhisthira also is doing like that. He's saying, I am a householder, therefore a householder, therefore charity is recommended. So Maharaj Yudhisthira was charitable, Maharaj Yudhisthira was giving to the Brahmanas, as a Kshatriya, respecting the Brahmanas. So in this way, he was following a code of behavior, which is not the pure transcendental platform of devotional service. So this chapter is basically dealing with that, and it is establishing how devotional service is transcendental to Varna Ashram. And that without minimizing the importance of Varna Ashram, like I said, Varna Ashram is above where we begin. So through Varna Ashram we become elevated. And we use it in that way. We take an ashram. But ultimately, it goes beyond that. For the service of Krishna, whatever is to be done, yena tena prakarena mana krishna sevi, and somehow or other, whatever the conditions of life are, we be focused on Krishna. Yena tena prakarena, prakar means whatever the conditions are, we focus on Krishna. That is our first and foremost thing. Just like Brahminical initiation, the second initiation, is, if we really look at it, it is not that from that day on we are Brahmanas, that it is about that, the second initiation. The essence of second initiation is not to be Brahmanas. The essence of the second initiation is not it is not meant that we are cultivating the qualities of the mode of goodness, that is our goal. Equanimity, austerity, religiousness, all these things are there. But one can perform, one can be as equipoised as anything under all circumstances, always balanced. One can be very austere, extremely austere. One can be very pious, religious inclined. One can be wise and not Krishna conscious. And then what is the use of all these things? When Krishna is not part of it, what is the use? On the other hand, if we, the first thing, Brahminical initiation then, is doing more. That Brahminical initiation is especially important in deity worship. One doesn't really need it to chant Hare Krishna. The Goswamis, they were taking off their threads. And the Babajis who were following them, they were following the Bhagavat mark, the path of simply chanting. And they were taking off the threads, not putting them on. Because they would rely only on the holy name. But if you worship the deity, then it is required. Like I yesterday mentioned, we worship the deity because that is a way to regulate our life. But that's again not the real thing about worshiping the deity. In worshipping the deity, when you step on the altar, you step into the spiritual world. Whoever is on the altar is actually in the spiritual world. But, although the devotees are in the spiritual world on the altar, they are not just walking around. They do everything according to prescribed rules and regulations. Everything according to directions of the scripture, which is the mode of goodness. Because although we are elevated to the spiritual world by the mercy of the Guru Parampara, and by the mercy of Krishna, who agrees to this whole system, we are not suitable to be in the spiritual world. We are like outsiders in the spiritual world. We don't really belong there. But still we're put there, on the altar, when we are engaged in deity worship. And all the arrangements there are like the arrangement in the spiritual world. Very opulent seating arrangements, thrones for Radha and Krishna, many arrangements of service, or beautiful decoration, beautiful clothing, delicious foodstuffs, the best of the best, all these things are being offered. And that is what is going on in the spiritual world. It's like in this material world, you can't leave your house without a phone. But in the spiritual world, you can't leave the house without an arctic tray. You have to have one with you at any time because there's always someone to worship. Arti is something like, hi, how are you? That's the start. Yeah? start to worship. That culture is spiritual culture. It is quite amazing. Everyone worships everyone. Everyone glorifies everyone. And in this way, there are loving exchanges, deeply respectful exchanges. Respect comes from recognizing good qualities in people. When we actually not only recognize them, but we actually deeply appreciate them. And when we truly think this person is absolutely wonderful because this person has amazing qualities, is actually very, very nice. So it's not that in the spiritual world there are just a few. Everybody is like that. And therefore everybody is full of wonderful qualities and everyone is appreciating everyone. And really, according to Srila Prabhupada, he explained that the material world is just a tiny little corner of the spiritual sky, and that little bit of the spiritual sky is covered by a cloud, just like here, and that therefore, right, we feel disconnected from the sunshine, yes, of the spiritual world. But the effulgence of Krishna, the Brahma Jyoti, is pervading in all directions, and then there is this little corner which is covered, a little corner of the spiritual sky which is covered by a cloud of illusion. And thus we think that we are separated from Krishna, and thus we think that Krishna is far away, and thus we think that we are alone, and therefore we think that we struggle. We think we are abandoned. We think we have to cope with things that we cannot cope with. How can all these things happen? And how do I deal with this? This is too much. This is no longer Krishna. Come on, you know, I mean, really, you know, give me a break. Krishna gave us a billion breaks, right? He gave us like not once, not twice, unlimited breaks all the time. And we just see, oh, so many trouble. But do you see how much mercy there was every time along with it? How you somehow or other, how it all went on. And something happened and we survived. Krishna is completely in control, or even of this little corner. Every moment. Not that sometimes he manifests his mercy. Krishna is manifesting his mercy all the time. All the time. Never is there a moment that Krishna withdraws his mercy. Krishna is known as the Avyakta Murtina, or the unmanifested form in the universe. You don't see him. Where is he? Can you hear the flute? You can hear? Yes? Yeah? Yes? Yeah? Can you? Yes? Yes? What? What you? Yes? Yes. He is going like, yes. I don't hear nothing. What can I say? Dutch, you know. Just on the ground, in the material world, somehow or other. But even if one cannot hear the flute, the sound of the flute was heard by Lord Brahma, and then came out of the mouth of Lord Brahma through the Gayatri Mantra. So through Gayatri Mantra we can hear Krishna's flute. That's that makes that second initiation a little more exciting. It's not only about being a Brahmana, it's not only about the motive, but you also hear the Gayatri Mantra, which was what came out of Brahma's mouth after hearing Krishna's flute. And it is said, the Gayatri Mantra is like the sound of Krishna's flute in mantra form. That is very interesting. That's why it's a secret mantra. What to do? But so Krishna is so much present, and we are so much in the spiritual world, and gradually, Om Agyana Divandasya, gradually the blindness of our eyes is being lifted by the mercy of the spiritual master. In this way, we become eligible to see. We have to see. It's not just we take initiation and it's like, oh great, now you know I am well connected to the parampara. This is very good. That's one aspect of it. But the idea is that we are going to hear Krishna's flute, that we're going to realize that we are already in the spiritual world. Going back to Godhead, that sounds like a long trip, you know.
Some people, they go to America, to Japan, or Australia, that's far. Some people, they say, go to the moon, although, we are not so convinced.
But whatever may be, right, people, they travel a long distance. But we find in the Brahma Samhita, Pantastu Koti Sattavatsara Sampragamyo Vayoradapi Manasu Munipungavam Yubhisthiyat Prapadichintya Vichintya Tatva Govinda Madhi Purushantam Aramvajami. You can travel with the speed of mind and still not touch the tip of the toe of the Lord. Speed of mind is very fast, faster than light. So many light years away and they go just with mind. But one cannot approach Krishna that way. But one can very easily attain Krishna. Right here and right now, in the middle of our life, whatever it is. I'm sure, I can tell you about my life. So I met someone yesterday, and they said, they really wanted to meet me, and then they said, I saw a video about your life on YouTube. And I say, oh my God. I didn't know it was there. That's terrible. My life on YouTube. Now everybody knows. It's a mess. That must be a video, must be a total mess, that video.
That's my life. Now you know,
it's a mess. My only solace is that probably your life is also a mess. So, in that way, I'm in good company. And many times, it was me who messed it up, to be honest. I did it myself. Not always, sometimes it got out of control, but many times I created the mess.
So, in the middle of all of this, we just embrace this amazing mercy. This amazing mercy of Lord Chaitanya.
And yesterday, I also had lots of discussions yesterday. I mean, the whole day was one big discussion. My head was buzzing in the night. And I don't know what was going on, but I had a strange dream last night. And the dream was that I was, for some reason, walking naked.
in the middle of the festival. All of you were here. And I was not wearing any clothes. And now I was wondering, shall I cover certain areas? Just let it be. And that was actually the question. That kind of puzzled my mind. And it was a long dream because I woke up with it. You have these dreams, and then when you wake up with it, you feel like you've been dreaming it the whole night. And I knew I had to sort of cross through the devotees, and then when I was on the other side, I could put on some clothes. Just sort of act as if it was okay. I can get psychological about it, and sort of I'm sitting here, and I guess I have to just expose myself, as to for what I am on this day, and not try and project some image, which is what we all do, usually. Try to make a good impression. And if something happens which upsets that good impression, how can they say this about me? Oh, I mean, people get a wrong impression. This is very bad. I mean, how could you say this about me? And you get into serious arguments with people. And they harm your impression that you make upon people. Somebody gave me a silk set, and I thought, okay, I'll wear it on my birthday. I'll honor it. But despite all these things, I'm not impressive. Even if some people may be impressed, that may be. People may be impressed, but I'll tell you the truth now. You may not believe it, but I'll take off all the false decoration. I'm not impressive. I'm mediocre. Mediocre. I'm somehow or another hanging on. And it's just all this mercy. Many times I didn't want it. Many times I really didn't want it. It gave me all this mercy, and I was thinking, oh God, do I have to surrender to this? Do I have to do this? It's like, it's too much, it's not human. But then, they pushed me, and then I did it. So it's really because of other people, over the years, many, many, that were very instrumental to save me. And not just my spiritual master, but many devotees over the years, who sort of made it possible. Some people who became my friends, just some people who were friends, real friends. Somehow or another, that Vyasa Mudra, that's my friend from Australia. We have to, when Aussies meet, they insult each other. That's the culture. Some even, one guy just punches the other in the face, and they punch back or drown or so. That's Australian culture for me. So I have that Ross with him. But he makes me do the craziest things. Like in Melbourne, there's this pool, and he always wants to take me to the pool, and then he goes and there's an exit onto the beach, and then he can take a dip in the ocean as well. So then he goes, the Melbourne footy team, they swim out to that buoy. The next moment I'm swimming out there.
really far, ridiculous, you know. I'm thinking, he's going to drown me, this guy. Anyway, I beat him now. He almost drowned. Yes, it's nice. Have some friends. We need friends in this movement. Right? All high philosophy will not do, because that's... We look up to the philosophy of Bhagavatam. And that's where our eyes are. But our feet are not there. We are looking upwards, but our feet are somewhere else on the ground. And we are struggling like that. So friendship is what we need. Some people who we appreciate. So part of this day is I see my disciples as my friends. It begins like that. There's a friendship. You know, it's not just like formal. I'm 34 in the parampara. 34, just in case. You didn't know. Coming straight from Krishna. And directly. Prabhupada is also there, not everybody. Vyasa. That's why I sit on the Vyasa. Okay. I guess somehow or other, that's part of the circus. Here I'm sitting, not walking on the high court, but sitting on a high seat. I hope there's a net somewhere. The mode of goodness. Whatever it may be, we are fulfilling roles and trying to make it meaningful. You take initiation and then nothing has changed. You're still the same, you always were. And now you have to make it meaningful. You have to take it and make something out of it. It's an individual thing. It's got nothing to do with me. I'll give you initiation, but it's not that I'm going to make you Krishna conscious. It's not going to... I can't make you Krishna conscious. It's I can simply give some information, you know, but, you got to do it. You got to take it. If you want, if you like. Yeah. It's up to you. Take it or leave it. What to do? I'm not going to cry. But, I wouldn't be happy if someone wouldn't make it. But there's nothing I can do. It's all up to you to make it meaningful. And that's the bottom line. You make your spiritual life meaningful. You know, as much as I do, maybe not as much as I do, but you know quite a bit. You know what you're supposed to do. And if you don't do it, what am I going to do? Come with the stick? I don't know. It's like, it's not my nature. It's not my nature. I'm not good at babysitting. I kind of feel, do it. Like, this is the chance. It's now. Such a rare opportunity. This chance, because now it's 500 years after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came. He comes once in the day of Brahma. And then Prabhupada came. It's only yesterday, so close. Now, so many blessings, so much available. What a chance we have now. You know, like something floating in the river and somehow or other coming really close to the shore. That happened to us. We came so close now.
to the spiritual world. So close. Now it's easier than ever. Easier than now we can do. All that mercy is there. And that's really what it's about. So all I can say, let's do it. Let's do it. I came to that point. My life was not just a little mess. It was a big mess. And I was in the wrong place at the wrong time, always. That was where I lived. I lived in the wrong places at the wrong times, doing the wrong things. And then one day I saw all these people, and it looked so miserable. I saw all of them, and tears started streaming from my eyes, just like rivers. Not like crying, just streaming. And I was looking at them, and I was thinking. And I prayed. I prayed to get out of there. So, take me out of here. And please, Lord, take me out of here. And then, after some time, the Hare Krishna movement came into my life. And that gave me a determination from I had enough. I really had enough of all the manners. Enough is enough. And so I didn't want any more. And that's why I fixed myself. And now it led to all of this. So yeah, let's do it. Let's take shelter. Let's take shelter. Let's take advantage. Let's make something of our spiritual life. Everyone flies his own plane. On the ground, the plane, there's all these people standing around the plane, putting fuel, checking the tires, checking the engines, putting some last things inside. You know, some people, they have headphones on, they have a wire, a cable which is connected with the cockpit, and they can talk to the pilots. So they tell the pilots, you know, what's going on, tires, checking this, you know, like fuel, this level, this pressure, everything. The pilots keep a master tap on it all and make sure that they got everything they need. And then they take off and they are in the sky. And there's ground control, but ground control cannot fly the plane. Ground control can tell you from a distance what to do. So while you are all in your planes, I'm ground control. And tell you could do this. You ask me something, should we go here? I say, well, if you go this route, you might not smash into the other plane. Or, you know. Well, maybe you should go a little higher because there are some mountains coming. Stuff like this. Watch out, don't fly too low. You know, there are trees there. I mean, if you go that direction, the landing might be rough. Things like that, ground control can say. But, you know, and watch out for the Bermuda Triangle. Because your heart just disappeared. So, in this way, we can give some good advice about flying your plane. But you're flying it. Everybody's flying it on his own. That's it. And different devotees, Krishna's Kaviras, Goswami said, are flying on different levels in the sky. And you can decide how high you want to fly. It's entirely up to you. The plane, go straight to the spiritual, but now it's up to us. Where are you going to fly to the heaven? Or where are you going to fly? I don't know, crash. Or go into the ocean of material misery. Bloop. Plane goes down. Whatever, it's up to you. Yeah, so those are my thoughts on this day. I'll try and be honest. I guess that's what the dream was all about. I am well dressed.
after that. I kind of took some extra time to draw some. No surprises. But any questions? Any questions? Just look around. Okay, we have.
Here.
There also. Okay, we have four.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. The question is, how to build, what are the principles of building good friendship? Because we have this ambition to be, to build devotee association, community involved. At the same time, we have a different level of understanding about Krishna, about Vedic living, civilization, all these things. But how can we build friendship when there are different levels of accepting these principles?
How can we build friendship when there are different levels and so on? Yeah, in the beginning we think that devotees are all residents of the spiritual world, or supposed to be. And then when they're not, then we're greatly disappointed in them. Later we appreciate more that devotees are human, and therefore not perfect. And we begin to see they are like me. They're actually also struggling, because we are struggling. And then we realize everyone is struggling. And then, when we are sharing that on the heart, you know, that human side in us, then friendships will develop, and we start to appreciate the Krishna consciousness that they are embracing. We see, this one is preaching so nice, that one is singing, you know, this one is studying the books, that one is worshipping the deity, whatever. They do such nice service, they're nice. You begin to appreciate them. Then you can start making friends. And done loving exchanges. Give some prasad, give a gift. So, yeah. In the beginning, we're all trying to be pure devotees immediately. And we all start to think, oh, they're not pure yet. Sure. We all try to be in there. But then you just after a while, you hit your head on a wall, right? And then you realize, I'm not so great. I need help. I need friends. That's how friendship comes. The wonderful people here. Everybody is worth a friendship. Okay. We can do a little exercise, you know, like, I mean, after the talk, everyone talk to your neighbor for a minute. But there's no time for that. Unfortunately. Yes.
I have a question about Varnashrama.
He has a question about Varnashram Dharma. And we have no discussion of Varnashram. This is the last question of Varnashram Dharma.
We hear a lot of classes and a lot of seminars.
That's
and
right.
I was thinking, most of us are working outside.
Yeah.
And we are not employed in our society, so to speak.
Our society? Okay.
And if we wouldn't have those classes and seminars, would it be any different for our life? I mean, for me sounds 100%.
Nothing to do with your everyday reality.
No, it has, but because I'm not working for ISKCON.
Yeah, I'm also not working for ISKCON.
If you can explain.
Self-employed.
It would be any different with those classes and seminars or without. I mean, it makes any difference for us. It's only theoretical or how is it?
ISKCON is an institution where Varna Ashram plays a role. Now, ISKCON doesn't begin or end at the fence of the temple. ISKCON is also every devotee who is somehow or other identifying with it. That's ISKCON. Yeah. So
the boundaries of ISKCON are not like hard boundaries that stop at the temples or at Krishna.com list of temples there. It's you're very much part of ISKCON. You've been touched by ISKCON. And Varna Ashram is in your life. No, Varna Ashram is not like a perfect fit, a suit you just jump into and it just, it's like a second skin. It's not like that. Varna Ashram is sort of, it doesn't really fit. You try it on, and so in some places it's too tight, in other places too wide, in some parts it's too short. Nobody fits in perfectly into Varna Ashram. But somehow or other, we take the spirit of it. Like, you've chosen for the Vyasa Ashram. Then there are some codes, there is a certain mentality, there's some recommendations. You can invite people to your home, you can feed people, and you can give in charity as much as you can. You can, in that way, you can take the spirit of Varna Ashram, even within the modern Kali Yuga, Ugra Karma society. And Ugra Karma means horrible works meant to destroy the world. So most of our jobs are touched by that. Like my father was involved in textiles, some big shot in that. And then the first time they took me to the factory, I got a tour. My father put me in a suit. And this kid in a suit and a tie, and they're taking me around. And the first thing I saw was all the wool come in. And there was so much blood on that wool. And I realized that even textiles is not clean. There's some ugra karma there. So it's everywhere. Career service. God knows what things you sometimes move around. One devotee came to me. I got a new job offer. They paid 3 times as much as that I'm earning now. It would really help me to kind of move along. Do you think I should take the job? So I'm talking to them. Well, you look at it. It depends on how much time you will have for your spiritual life. And then after about 15 minutes, I say, what is it anyway, that job? Then he says, it's in a weapon factory. Now we can take Varna Ashram into our life, principles of it, to the extent that it fits. And where it doesn't fit, just let it be. Vaidiki Lokiki Vapuyat Kriya Kriyate Mune Hari Seva Kundaiva. Sri Rupa Goswami said, Vedic Varna Ashram or just practical, worldly arrangements, whatever is favorable for the servant of the Lord. Use Varna Ashram to the extent that it is favorable. And where it doesn't fit, don't worry about it. Manu Samhita gives like lots of details. When you see a superior, you have to walk backwards, right? Always facing. You might get run over by a car. There are no cars in the Manu Samhita, So don't do that. Yeah. Yesterday, someone offers obeisances on the middle of the road there. It goes down. I mean, cars are coming fast, Don't do that. let's not get carried away by being too vain. Let's be practical. So both. Next. Loud.
In the Srila Prabhupada's books, everything's set and everything's there. But apart from that, in ISKCON we have a lot of opinions and emphasis, different ones. And I'd like to clarify with you which ones I should take. At the same time, I can't keep approaching it.
We'll make a list of all the opinions, and then
take the ones that are okay. No, I said before, it should be practical, right? That's not practical. So, the books are like the teachings of Prabhupada, his books, his lectures, and so on, are like our anchor. Then we get more information from the previous acharyas and so on. So in this way, we get information and we get a general idea of what to do. And then we are, in the 11th canto, it says, one must apply that knowledge with one's own intelligence. So we judge the circumstances, and sometimes we have here an opinion of a Vaishnava, and we think, I don't know, I don't fully feel like that. I have some doubts about that opinion. All right, then we may not immediately buy into it, and we put that on the shelf. We're not going against it also, we just put it on the shelf. You know, I'm not sure about this. And then in the course of being with other Vaishnavas, we get more information on the same point and more angles of it, and then we get some vision on that particular topic, how to deal with it. So that's why you shouldn't just deal like in the mode of passion, and as soon as you hear like, you know, something, you think it's awful, say it's awful. Yeah, I mean, but that's ridiculous, or that's awful. Forget it, I'm not gonna do that. That is not the best way to proceed. Best put it on the shelf, hear from the Vaishnavas, absorb more, and then proceed carefully and thoughtfully. But everyone flies his own plane. So you gotta figure it out. Good luck. Happy flying. Last question and then the end. There's a time schedule. So you get a short answer.
So the question is, if the essence of Brahmanical initiation is to hear the Krishna's flute.
Yes. And to enter and to become overwhelmed with love. What is the use of poetry when it doesn't pierce the heart like an arrow and make the head spin? So Gayatri is poetry. Gayatri pierces the heart like an arrow and makes the head spin. That's the idea of it. Yeah? But not today. It takes more time. So talking about time, our time is up. So thank you so much. We'll meet again in the hall at 10 o'clock. I don't know if someone has announcements.